Hallelujah. I want to begin this teaching today, this preaching. And in order to do that, I want to revisit a verse that we constantly, or I have in the last teachings, I have begun the teaching here in Revelation Gil-Iana, the revealing of Yah's mighty truth in Yeshua HaMashiach. That's what Revelation is. It is the hand of Yah revealed through the power or the concept of flesh, whereby we can realize with great understanding it is from Yah. Our flesh constantly wrestles and battles until we wrestle so with truth that it has no power in our bosom. And so as one began his trek by the Ruach of Yahakahanan, Yah began to reveal unto him the might of Yeshua HaMashiach. And he showed him one of the most profound signs of this Acharith, the time of the end, that what shall be. There shall be great zara, great trials of afflictions and agony because of the sin of the people of Almighty Yah. We have sinned with the willingness. Any time we defy Yah, disobey Him, that's sin. When an Israel knows what is right to do and we do it not, it's sin. It is a vile thing. And that's what the Torah teaches us. We know that the Torah teaches that, and yet because we have not read it, we don't see it, we don't understand the value of it. We must still write Israel. He utters here to us in Revelation chapter 17, verse 4. He tells us of this woman, this religious harlot. She was arrayed herself in the colors of scarlet. And she was decked with gold and precious stone. Revelation 17:4. And this is what I want to emphasize again with a little more detail. Having a golden cup, min achif. It is a cup, a minachith. It is a cup. It is a disposition. It is a mind. It is a will, a desire to offer up offerings that are sacrificial unto the devious powers of hell. What is in the cup of Yisrael? A cup is a reservoir to hold, to maintain. It is utilized to drink from, to sip from, to refresh one from. So what cup are we drinking from? What is the source of our refreshments? What causes our love to delight and to rejoice in the Torah of Yah? Are we drinking from this cup of delusion? She has a cup. And it says in that cup, in her hand, and it is male, it is full, Yisrael, of abominations and nidah, some of the most vilest and the most unclean, idolatrous practices that one could ever practice. When one gives lead way and strength unto their mind, when they began to mutter and speak to themselves, I will deal with that. And they charm themselves by seduction of their own damnable, twisted mind of treachery, that they will not obey Yah. That's an offering unto the most idolatrous, devious workings of hell that one can imagine, and they don't even know of. It is an uth, it is a mark in their mesach, in their head. It is the strength of their Rosh Yisrael. They have drink from this cup. When you give one a cup, it is to drink out of. And the cup is full of arsenic. It is full of death, Yisrael. And Yah says the ingredients in that cup, they are precise. It is the nidah. It is our filthy, wicked ways of the ministerak of a woman, that our minds are so unclean that the power of the pure Torah of Yah excites us not. It is the mark, it is the oath of a beast. For the beast has no. I was saying to Ach Simeon yesterday, as we were discussing the kidding of some of the goats. So I asked him about the little pygmy, she's been with us for a long time. I said, I watched those two billies run that beast as though that they would destroy her. The young one was pursuing her, and the elders of the goats were pursuing him because he was not going to give him leeway to take advantage of that situation. And I watched them. It was almost frightening. The way that he ran his horns into him and even into her, because his passion, his bestiality, nothing was going to beat that. And that is Yisrael. We got a beast nature. I don't care how Yah speaks to us. I don't care if he prophesy nice things to us. It doesn't bring the resolution. There's only one thing, correction. We must correct Arabe. And Yah corrects his children. He commands us to spare them not because of their crying. Damn your kara, your tears and your crying. If he commands us to do that, you think that he is not going to do the same thing? He said, because in that rod of correction, you save their soul, their nephesh, from hell. And he's going to correct us. That's the only way, Yisrael. We cannot allow this nida, this filthy, this minister flow of a woman that never ceases. The one that had the issue of this blood flowing. That no one touched her because she was unclean. Yet the power of Torah was the source to heal her and to stop the flow of the blood. Spit all she had with doctors and charmers and healers. Yet she was no bit better, and that's us. We'll spit all that we had on trinkets and lies and satisfactions, but we are not healed, Yisrael. We're trying to heal ourselves, and we're not healed. And the filthy blood flow from our mind. This nida, this idolatry, appetite of unclean things constantly flow from our mind because there is a mark there. It is the nature of a beast. It is the mark of man. When a man has not his head covered by Yahshua HaMashiach. We see this in this doctrine today whereby many are denying the HaMashiach. They think that they are men. They have strength and character. And they say Yah told them. No, they are hearing what someone else has said. They have been trained by someone else. What? A twisted generation of liars and deceivers. It is the truth, my young unk. Hallelujah. She had a cup in her hand, and it was full of abomination and nida and zana, fornication. It was full of that which is vile. I did a cabalation yesterday, and I want to read the definitive of the word, what is vile or depraved or perverse. This is in the cup. What is in the cup? What a cup is a tool for holding and dispensing, isn't it? And that's what the leb is, the leba. It is a cup to hold and dispense. What is in our minds constantly? What are the concepts and the thoughts of our mind? I want to read this definitive of the words. In the Hebrew, it is ovon or ovin, but depraved or vile. It is malignant. You hear that? I want you to hear these definitions. This is from a consortment of dictionaries and Greek lexicon and Hebrew lexicon and Merriam-Webster and different resources that I utilize. That it will be broken down to the simplicity of our learning that we can understand. But it is malignant. It is malice. There is an ill will. It is a desire to injure, to decapitate, to destroy. There is wickedness there. There is depravity. The mind cannot absorb. It cannot absorb anything that is of truth or the nature of truth. It is a wickedness that one is not ashamed to break the Torah. It is so violent and defiant. One practice their wickedness and they say, I don't give a damn what has been commanded. And they break the Torah of Yah without any concept of the consequences. That's a depraved, a vile, a wicked mind. That's a mind that has been drinking from the cup of destruction, from this religious harlot's cup. It is a mind that is evil. A mind that is troubled by everything. It is a mind, listen, that is depraved, cannot, there is not a passion. It doesn't give a damn. When Yah corrects us, we ought to have the passion. Passion is expressed by one's physical expression from the mesach. They have no compassion. When the ish expressed that to his Isha, there has to be an expression. When she expressed that, there is something in her eyes that allures and draws something from him he didn't even know he had. Quiet. It is an affliction of the mind. That's what depravity, that's what vile is. In her golden, her seductive cup, it was full of pechgul, some of the most vilest of substance. It was full of shithuts. It was full of te'eba, just simply shisting, even that which passes out of your anal cavity is greater than what this vile thing offers unto Yah. We offer resentment and rejection. It is the senility of the mark of this vile beast. And unless we repent, Yisrael, Yah says, I gave her space of time to repent. He says, if you don't, I will come quickly and I'm going to bruise the hell out of your children you're obeying. We don't buy it. Because we make Yah a liar. We must come to the reality of whom we are and who he is. He's greater than us. He made us because he wants the fellowship. He has the creation, the fellowship with them, but he made something that's lower than them. And he crowned us with his beauty, with his breath of life. He is enthralled that he is mindful. What is man that he is mindful of man? What is the son of man that he visiteth us daily with breath and light, the rising of the sun, the going down of the sun? Come on, Yisrael. It is an affliction of the mind. It is an affliction of your emotions. That's why people are up today and they're crazy as hell tomorrow. It is an affliction of corruption of one's mind, of one's emotion, of one's passion, and they have an inordinate affection. They smile with you today, and they don't know you tomorrow. They embrace you 1 minute, and they turn their back. That's inordinate. That's inordinate. You hear me, my friend? I have met men that way. I've met women that way. I've met that among Yisrael. That they love me, but their affection is inordinate. It's out of the realm of the developed love whereby the Torah develops in one mind. This beast and this cup of the sluttish Jezebel must develop a mind that is so depraved that it hates Soni. It hates with a great passion. Yeah, that's what she is doing. And she must raise up a children that take a delight in receiving the mark or the very conscience of her mind. She developed their conscience in her mind. And she's constantly on the job. She's constantly. It is that inordinate affection, listen to this, governed by mere human nature, not by the Ruach of Yah. It is a mind that is governed by the inordinate, vile affections of human nature, but not by the Ruach HaKodesh. Because the Ruach leads and guides us into kol imach kol, into all truth. So this man is not delightful. It doesn't rejoice in the truth of Yah. It doesn't rejoice in the truth of who I am, what I am, my situation, my deeds. It doesn't rejoice in that. But it rejoices in that what it perceives of you and me and others. But it doesn't rejoice in Yah's hands upon me. It is a depraved mind. It is a mind of Ovin, Ovon. It is a mind that is so corrupt that even the offerings are not accepted by Yah. The prayer, the pala, the tefillah of the wicked, it is an abomination unto Almighty Yah, even the prayers. And so the wicked one got everyone praying today. But Yah says, out of that abominable cesspool of pichul, that prayer's vow, you offering that up unto the deities of hell, and you can't get by me. I see the mark. It is a mind that is absent of Torah delight. It is a heart that has been marked by this vile satisfaction of one's bosom, that they delight in everything that is wicked and corrupt. We should delight in the Mishpatim, the judgments of Yah. We should delight in the corrections of Yah. And yet we are a nation that do not delight in that. Woe unto us as a people. The book is not written to the nations of the world. It's not written to them, to the Goim, the heathens. It's written to Yisrael. There are those that will read books over and over and over and over again. There are those that watch movies like Scarface 100 times. They love it. They over it. There are those that watch movies like The Color Purple over and over and over and over. They will do that. But we as a nation of Yah, the people of Yah, we don't delight in the Torah over and over, hearing the same things over, over and over again. Yeah. We don't delight in that. Yeah. It says that in the definitives of this depravity, this vile, this ovun, this ovin, this corrupt nature, it is a man, it is the animal nature with craving which incite to sin. See, the nature of a beast has no concept of what passion is. I watched them run that goat yesterday. I started to take a stick and stop those beasts, but that's their nature. And we are quick to run to sin because our minds drive us that way. Our passion drives us to that which is wicked. And I watch how they ran this, and she's old by animal terminology. She's old. She has endured like no other goat we have had. And I like her. She's the only goat that comes up to me. She's the only goat that comes by me. She is the only one that I can literally touch. She knows me. And the other ones are beasts. So it is a mind that is incited. When a mind is excited, it is incited that there are things that cause it with great enthusiasm to sin. Then that's the nature of a beast. It is the mark of a beast. When our minds are incited, when there's a passion, a desire, when there's a driven proclivity, a motion, a passion to sin, that's the nature of a beast. That's the mark of a beast. It's a mind that is absent from the living breath of the testimony of Yeshua, because there is no Ruach HaKodesh. There's no life in that mind. That's a dead head. And a dead head is one that practices sin. When sin is finished, it brings forth death, a separation. The mind is separate from Yah. When we carry out the process of sin in our mind, it separates us from Almighty Yah. And separate our thoughts from Yah. Separate our passion from Yah. Hallelujah. It is a mind that is bazaar. It is vile. Bazaar. It is vile. It is a fleshly mind. Because it is worthless. It's not even worth the damn dust it was made of. The dust is more valuable. It is a mind that is vile. It is bazaar. It is worthless. There's nothing of substance there. Nothing at all. You do not commune with the goats and go to the field and sit down and talk to them. For their minds are worthless. There's nothing in their minds to teach you. And there is nothing in the nature of a beast or this beast world to teach us. And yet we commune with this mind. We commune with this mind. And we allow this mind to teach us. It is what satisfies us. It is what gratifies us. It is what incites us. It is what fulfills us. It is what causes our passion and our desire to be developed. That should not be. It must come from the only pure mind. And that's the mind of the Torah. It must come from those that they are exemplary according to the Torah. The Torah tells us to mark a perfect man, to mark a perfect Isha, to mark a perfect Isha. The Isha comes from the Isha. To mark a perfect man, for the end of that man is Shalom. He takes comfort in what Yah does. But a man is Tomim, he is a man that his conscience is completely developed in Torah. His passion has been shaped by the Torah. His will, his pleasure, his hafetz, his pleasure is shaped by the Torah of Yah. It's not shaped by the comedy of folly and frivolity and the cup of this wicked religious self-identity, faith, one's own belief. This is what I believe. Damn your wicked beliefs. They don't mean a damn thing to Yah. What you believe doesn't mean one damn thing. What you have concluded by your own private, wicked, ill interpretation, it has no damn value at all because you don't even count it for value. You live like a damn beast. You live like a damn dog. We saw an example of that the other day. I saw this little clip. I want you all to see it. I said to my Isha, please look at this. Whereby they raise up this vile thing here in Atlanta, in Lithuania. This corrupt thing that call himself a Jew. It's amazing that those that call themselves Jews, how they will go into the whorehouses of the people of the diasporas and cause them to have this great reverence for this false, deceitful identity of a people that is not of the birth of Abraham. You understand? And I said to my Isha, the most appalling thing was all of these women just in gyration of the folly that was presented unto them and these damn effeminate faggot men. I don't take a damn thing back. And this damn beast that calls himself a Jew, I have no problem with that. Wrapped him in what he called the Torah. They set this damn wig-wearing faggot of a beast, this abominable cup of wickedness that spew lies and fill the minds of the people with lies. They set him in a royal chair. And these damn weak men hoisted him. And this damn corrupt thing that calls himself a Jew, he prophesied this truth from the belly. Do you hear me? He prophesied a truth. That lying, deceiving man that said he was a Jew, that he had dual citizenship in Israel and in America. He prophesied unto that beast of hell, Eddie the Dog Long. He prophesied a truth. He said that you are raised up as a king. He was raised up as a czar. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities. He said that God has raised you up as a prince. You have a new anointing. You're going to seduce these gullible ones that are given unto the seal of the beast's mind. And they shall go down into the crevice of hell right along with you. And the women just shook in their damn wicked, abominable outfits. I want to get to something today. You don't have to stay with me. That's all right. And they began in these gyrations. As I looked, it's about 10 minutes. I seethed with anger, but I said, yeah, this is your plan. In all things we give Todah. And yet even a Sadiq man, we won't even give him a cup of water in the name of a Sadiq man. We will not say, my Sadiq, ach, Rosh Yosef, I will take care of this for you. We won't even do that. But the wicked, one will die for him. Nobody's going to die for me. I don't want you to. I will die for me. I'll die for you too. I lay down my life. I lay down my own personal gain. There's nothing for me to gain but death. There's nothing for me to gain but death. That's all I can gain in this world. That's all the world offers is death. One last thing on this word, deprave, ovon, ovin. And I want to take us into the cup, what brimmed from this golden cup, that we can identify any trace element of that in us. It says, it is a mind that is worthless. It is a mind that despises. We hate our brother, our sister, without a cause. When you despise someone, you don't want their fellowship. There is no love of unity among you. It is a mind that holds the Torah of Yah in contempt because it has disdained for Almighty Yah. What has caused this kind of development, not among the world, but among Yah's people? That's where you're going to find that mark and its tremendous identity among his people. Well, the Torah doesn't say that, but the writing of one of the most profound messengers of the time after the death of Yahshua, his name is Shaul. He writes in the book and he gives me a detailed analogy and he gives me precise indications of that mind that is against Yah, that mind of the mark, a mind that is empty, is not full with the Ruach of Yah. He shows me in the book of Romeya, the book of Romans. Let's move that quickly. Romans chapter 1 and verse 18. I want you to hear this. This is the sin of the nations, the sin of Yisrael. It is revealed unto us. That's what the Torah does. Before there was a Torah, there was no revelation of sin. When the Torah came, sin was revealed. And we know that sin is the transgressing, the defying, the denouncing of the Torah of Almighty Yah. And Shaul speaks with such edification, with such knowledge, with such strength, with such awareness unto us to warn us. He begins here in chapter 1 of Romeya and verse 18. I would have begun there. He lets us know that, first of all, that the za'af, the wrath, the za'af is the tremendous rage. Have you ever gone into a rage in your life? I have. And when you rage, you don't give a damn about anything. It's just that Yah had his hands on you to control that rage. You would have destroyed everything in your presence. There are those that go in a rage, they destroy. That's what a rage is. And this is not man's rage. It is the za'af. It is the raging mind. It is as a torrential rain or the sea that rises up with a vehement type of wind that blows upon it. And the wrath. The storming and the storms of his indignation. It tells us it's the wrath of Yah, doesn't it? The wrath of Yah, not the wrath of man. But the wrath of Yah is revealed. It is made known, revealed from Hashemah, the heavens, against not some, but all. We must define what is this ovon. This depraved mind against all wickedness of evil, of unrighteousness. And the evil, or the unrighteous nature of a man, it is one when he defies adamantly with disdain for consequences the Torah of Yah. He does it in an adamant fashion. He does it and he says, I don't give a damn what anyone says. It's a man that says, I will not do it. It's almost like a stubborn child in my days when my Ema would say, don't be stubborn. And when she began to correct me, I would stiffen up and I would show my defiance. I don't care how you whip me, I'm not going to cry. And when I did that, it gave her more resolve. It caused her backbone to become erect. It caused the strength of that right arm to bear down. It caused a revival of breath in that woman. Jesus, you will not break me. This wheel must be broken. We are not going to break you. And that's what this unrighteousness is. It is an evil. It is the nature that says to you, I don't give a damn. You're going to capitulate. You're going to change. You're going to evolve yourself into a manner that is a sociable, acceptable unto my desires and my mandates for you. Yah says in hell, you will lift up your eyes. For he is the mighty one and he changed not, Yisrael. I'm going to bring this home simple today, all right? Hallelujah. He said, against all the evil deeds of this evil, they're deeds that are contemplated in our minds that are not based upon the principles of Torah. They're deeds that are evil, the deeds of injustice. They're deeds that are unjust. We can be unjust with our chot. We can do injustice unto each other because we don't have the mind of Yahshua HaMashiach. Our passion, our emotions are depraved because we have drink from this cup of harlotry. Our own religious spirit, our own desires in our practitioners or our practice of our religious ways. We have learned from this dirty whole world. We have learned from the Baptists. We've learned from the Methodists. We've learned from the Pentecostals. We'll learn from the holiness. We'll learn from the Jesus thumpers and the damn Jesus talkers. But we have not learned the ways of Yah. You have not so learned the ways of Yah. Not one bit at all. We have not learned to do righteous. We have learned to do evil. We have learned to say, I don't give a damn what the Torah says. I develop my concepts by my emotions, my feeling. I will go to the well of darkness and you drink from this damn dirty cup. You have disdain for Yisrael. You have disdain for the body of Yahshua. We speak against the body of Yahshua. There is no reverence. We don't esteem the body of Yahshua. We should esteem one another more highly than ourselves, Yisrael. That's a wickedness. That's a corruption. It's vile. It's impugnant. It stinks. It's evil. It's depraved. It's inordinate. It is the nature of a vile beast. It is incited by your own driven wicked mandate that you think you're going to overthrow Yah. We're damn fools if we think that. You can forget that. You will go to hell thinking that. Don't worry, you will. Hallelujah. Pressing on. He says, for the wrath of Yah is revealed from the heavens against all wickedness and unrighteousness of men. And this is profound here. He says, who lafa, who hom. You see that? Who lafa. They twist and they bend. They make the Torah acceptable in a vile mind. They twist it, they bend it, they contort it, they wrestle with it to make it they lafa. They make the Torah presentable to a mind that doesn't give a damn, a mind that is so absent of Yah's truth. So they laugh, they twist, they hold the truth in evil, in a distorted, evil, wicked, unrighteous heart and mind that has been developed by the forces of hell to do evil injustice of deeds against Yah, to speak against Yah, to deny his HaMashiach. That's why you have the rise of these serpents of hell. They call themselves Hebrews, and they deny the very power of Yahshua HaMashiach. They shall lift their eyes in hell, and they try to do with a rational, intellectual knowledge. They think they have a high IQ. You understand? They think they have a high spiritual IQ. They're intellectual quotient. That's what IQ is, intellectual quoting. It is the sum or the accumulation of matters, of numbers, or repeating of certain things that one is able to retain in their mind. So they think they have a spiritual high level that is of an IQ above everyone. So they can ration and reason and explain things. This must be revealed. Did it not say, for the wrath of Yah is revealed? It says the wrath of Yah is revealed from the heavens. It's revealed. And it's going to be revealed. Man will not know it's the wrath of Yah. Only Yisra'iyah will know that Yisra'iyah. Hallelujah. They love. They hold, they twist, they bend, they corrupt the truth of Yah, and they do it in an unrighteous, a wicked mind. It is the mind of the mark of beast and man. One of the first acts of the woman man, it was to rebel against the authority of Almighty Yah. And because of that, we saw the proliferation of sin and death, and death is a separation. When I leave this realm, I will separate from her. When I leave you, I will separate from you. And once we die, you don't play, you don't touch the unclean body. Let it rot in the grave. You're not saying anything, man. I know that he is saying everything. Can I press a little farther? They hold the Torah of Yah in unrighteousness. These are conscience and minds that have drink from the cup of this religious whore. And they are men and women that rich literally and actually from this menachi, from this cup, they offer up offerings unto the powers of hell. That's why in these whole houses they can go and then do the muttering or the giddishing and the cries. They can do all that damned up a twisted mess. It is not the language of Yah. Every language that one speaks by the power of the Ruach. And that's not the most important thing among Yisra'iyah. It is the office of the Shulishim. It's the prophet. It's the Nobi. And that is one of the least things that it should be manifest in the house of Yah. And they go, Yah! And they're crying out to spirits of hell. That's what they're doing. It's a spirit of charming, of conjuring. It is satanic. It is not of Yah. I'd rather speak 10 words that you can understand, or to utter with something like that, you don't understand a damn thing. And when a stranger walk in, they say, what in the hell is that? What language he is speaking in? And if there be the efficacy of the languages of Yah, let it be done in the process that Yah command, and then let there be an interpreter among us to speak as to the edifying of the body of Yahshua HaMashiach. Some of these jackasses of men, they are so entrenched in this damnable, twisted Christian corrupt doctrine that they hold fast to these damn pseudo things that they think are real. Hallelujah. Verse 19. It says this, hear this carefully. I know we're not excellent at hearing. He said, because that which could or may be known of Yah is manifested in them, for Yah has shown it to them. How has he shown us the greatness of his power, of his might? He tells us in the next verse, for the invisible thing, even breath is invisible. The air. For the invisible things come from him. They come from Yah. From the creation of the world. If we can see the world, these ignorant pseudo things we call scientists, that tell you they found a rock that is 3 billion years old. That is so stupid. And people buy that from these devious damn liars. Oh, through the carbon impressions and through the carbon, we have ways of testing to tell you the age. You're a damn liar, man. You're a flat out liar. You don't know. You really don't. They don't know. They don't know when y'all made this volume of this spear. They don't know. You can measure it in the time of man. We know when he put man on this earth. You cannot measure it in the volume of man. So you're a damn liar. The pseudoscience is a lie. It's false, just like the pseudo prophets. He said, those things are clearly seen, being understood by the things of creation. Now, everything about Yah, you can understand it from creation. Go out there and look at the ants. Look at creation. Look at the flower. You can even visibly discern the pure colors of a flower. My eyes are not as sharp as they used to be. And there was a time that you could see beautiful colors and the richness of the colors of flowers. But now, as you grow a little older, you don't see it as more clearly. But still in that, it's still beautiful. It's not like the created colors that man makes. It's something about Yah's colors you cannot duplicate. That the pigment of the eyes, the luring of that power, it's that there are no expressive terminology to express just by looking at what has been created. We know that there is one that is greater. That our concept and what we see. He said those things are understood by those things of creation. It says even his eternal power and the essence of whom he is. We can see what has been created, a flower, a seed. Who can create a seed? We cannot. We cannot allow the seed of the evil one to be planted in our minds. When we become hostile against Yah, when our minds began to refute, reject what Yah speaks unto us, we're allowing the seed of darkness to be entrenched and rooted in our minds. You have some kind of Torah teaching to substantiate that, man? Well, I will get to that, all right? Which is the essence of Yah, so that they are without excuse. He's saying us, we have no excuse, Yisrael. There is no excuse for us at all. You may think that you're going to get by, but you're not getting by, my people. You're without any excuse because he has made it known unto all men who he is, what he is, and the power of his might. And then in verse 21, Romans 1:21, it said, because that when they knew, yeah, you tell me, he is speaking to a people that Yada, because when they knew Yah, because when they experienced Yah, is not that what these words are conveying? Because when they Yada, because when they experienced the breath of Yah, we experience that in his creation every day. We experience that in life every day. Because when they knew Yah, I want you to hear this. Because when they knew Yah, they magnified and honored him in a mighty way. Because when they knew Yah, do we know Yah today? Be careful. Don't speak so quickly. Because when they Yah the Yah, when they experience his fellowship, where two or three are gathered, there shall he also be in the midst. When they experience his fellowship, when they experience his presence in the midst, he said, they did not honor me, they did not esteem me as Yah. Do you understand? Do you see why I said what I said in the beginning of this teaching? I'm here to receive and to honor Yah. Are you here for that? So we have more than two or three. So when there's more than two or three, then we must magnify him as the mighty creator. Because when they knew Yah, just by the breath that he grants you today, you know that it is not some form of scientific evolution. It's greater than that. It is of a mighty intellectual design that is beyond the expression of intellect as we know it. You can't compare that with the intellectual quoting. It's beyond the IQ of man. It's Yah's IQ. is his qualifying of things. It's beyond that. You don't get that out of a filthy, damnable, polluted mind. You don't drink from this vile cup and get that, Yisra'iyah. When they knew Yah, when they knew the power of Yah, when they knew the deliverance of Yah, when you woke up this morning and your bones were aching, you could not get up, but yet he brought you up. And you don't magnify him, something is twisted in your damn mind. When you struggle in your mind, when you struggle in your emotion, when you struggle in the battles and the opposition of Yah, and you didn't magnify Yah for that, when they knew Yah. When they yada, when they experience, when they had praises in their mouth, when they knew Yah, they magnified him not. When you walk out there, Toda Yah. Hallelujah. I do things, I cry and I rejoice. I may not cry here, but I cry, I weep. Sweat pouring down and tears pouring down. Hallelujah. That I testify to the Melechim that are encamped about me. Come on, Yisra'iyah. And when they knew Yah, when they yada, when they experienced him, you know he woke me up this morning and he started me on his way. Oh, he did. Yahshua, he is blessing me right now, oh, right now. He is, you know, the old ones that will rejoice. As a young ignorant man, although we all were ignorant, when I would see the old mothers and they would sing, it made a great impact upon me. I've always loved the old men, and I love the older women when they operate in a ruach that is beautiful. I despise an old woman that thinks that she's holding something. You're holding nothing but bones and wrinkled skin, just like everyone's skin is going to get. You're not fine. You're not firm as a damn apple. You're soft as anyone else. Stop that. I despise that. And that's a fact. And you literally think you're holding something. What you ought to be doing is holding the truth in your yard. I hate that about a foolish old man, a stupid old jackass of a man, to think that he's virile and young and he wants to bebop like a jitterbug. I don't want to bebop like a jitterbug. I want to be outstanding, my character. When I walk in a place, I want you to notice me. Not because I got money, because I got him. I have the lamp, he's near. Near. Hallelujah. And when, because that when they knew Yah, they magnified and honored him not as the Most High, neither were they Toda. We should enter into the tabernacle of Yah. We don't do it. When we enter into the earth, into the open air, he grants unto us his beauty of his creation. So anytime we in his presence, we ought to say, To the Yah for Yahshua HaMashiach, my Yahshach, To the Yah for Yahshua, my Yahshach. Toraya for the rain, Toraya for life he has granted unto me, O my love, rejoice, O Yah. Toraya for everything and all things, we give thanks unto Yah. He said, and neither we are a wicked generation, that mind of the beast doesn't thank Yah. The old ones will say in the midst of all the agony, as I'm going on, I want to, as I'm going on to, oh, yes, as is. They didn't say, yes, I am. Damn the proper etiquette of language. As I'm going on through, oh, yeah, yes, I is, yes, I is. All the trouble, trials come, I trust in Yahshua, oh, as I'm going, and going on through. And the one that was in agony of pain, they rose up and began to dance. And the one who came in whose love was low and unrepentant, they picked up the timbre or just began the song. As I go on through, as I go on through, as I go, going on through. And the one began the song. She began to weep because she knew that the hand of Yah was real. She knew that the hand of Yah was real. And if he doesn't mean a damn thing to us, then we're not going to exemplify the realness of Yah. And that's the fact, Yisra'iyah. And as we get old, he should be more real to us because we're destined for a date that he has set in the heavens above. We're destined for a time and a season and a date where we must lay off this body of clay. And that's a fact. In time that we grow up in the spiritual things of Yah. And when they knew Yah, when they experienced the power of his hand, he woke you up this morning. It wasn't by your strength. When they knew Yah, they did not honor him. They did not magnify him. And neither were they Torah. They were not thankful. That mind, that depraved, corrupt mind, that drinks from the cup of death, that mind of the beast, that seal, that oath, that allegiance to hell, it will not thank Yah. It is almost like a child, the mother corrects them, or the avat, and the child is stubborn. That's the way we are. We can hear Yah. He speaks to us and say, Dawid, your ways are wicked. Dawid Yisra'iyah. You must treat Yahweh Sadak the same as you treat Yarameyah. You must treat Yarameyah the same as you do yourself. You cannot be partial. You must be fair in every aspect. Oh, you cannot do this or hold wrong because of your emotional deranged attitude, because you have sat at the table of demons and devils. You have drink off of the filthy, the nida table of hell. You have eaten the dainties of hell, and your mind is not developed by the tough things of Yah, and you acted in a way that is full of deceit. It is the way of treachery and darkness. You must come up. And the only way you're going to come up, you must hear the power of the testimony of his truth. And that's why the enemy is trying to snuff out any true messenger of Yah. Hell, the people, come on. They lift up that faggot down there and they give millions of dollars. Hell, you can't get $20 or $100 to come in here to sustain this. But we give every damn dime to Walmart. We take all the extras to Walmart. They lift up that faggot beast any long the other day. It is so violent, so corrupt, so wicked. The man with a wig on up to here. Come on, man. You're going bald in the top. Cut this down low and let it go bald. That's all you do. It gives you a distinguished look. That's what it does. You're going bald there. Just cut it down on the side. Cut this in a way that it accents your beard. That's all you got to do. Take the damn wig off the Jerry Curl wig and the makeup you put on. That's not even faggism. Take it off, man. You got a wig sitting up here on the top of your head. That's wrong. Vanity, 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 says the preaching man. You're vain. You're vain. You don't have to worry about me putting on the wig or getting your Jerry Curl. You don't have to worry about that, all right? Hallelujah. Because when they knew Yah, they were not, they magnified him not as Yah, neither were they thankful. But became, now because when they knew him, because we don't listen now, because you don't thank Yah, because you don't magnify him, then you become vain, you become empty, you become shav. You become vain in their yetzah, in their imagination. And the imagination is what we purpose in our mind, how our mind frames things, what we devise in our mind. And so if we don't do what Yah commands us, then our imagination becomes vain, Yisra'iyah. We began to frame things that are so evil, so sadistic, so wicked, so vile. We began to go to this whore and drink from this religious cup. We began to take upon the nature of a beast, of an animal, of a wild, untrained animal. And so when the master come, you rise this up, although he feeds you with breath in the morning, although he feeds you with life, although he feeds you with strength to get up, you rise up in your damn twisted mind, and then you pose ya as a beast. This is what's going to take us into the kingdom. We're not going with these rosy type lies that these men are uttering. They became vain in their imagination. They became vain in their thoughts. And this is the catalyst. And they're foolish. They're foolish. Their hearts of stupidity. Their foolish hearts left was darkened. Only when the heart is darkened, it opens the door to every kind of pichul, every kind of shitchutz, unclean, depraved thought, and wicked framing in one's yetzer, your imagination, your levah. And because of that, the mind is given over unto darkness, unto hoshech, unto the darkness whereby the light does not shine. There are holes they call in this sphere, in this universe, and they call them black holes. And scientists, in their feeble attempt, they have the ability to shine light, but this light is not like the light of Yah. Yah sees into the darkness of places. The light cannot even penetrate. It cannot even penetrate. And what a mind is that hoshach, where the Torah doesn't penetrate, you may seem nice, you may be religious, you may go to your whole house every Sunday, every first day, you may lift up your damn twisted Jesus and your Lord and your God. When that mind is so dark that you speak about the Shabbat, they defy. When you speak about his name, they don't want to hear. That is a mind that is hoshach. It is the dark mind. It is a mind that is so dark, nothing is going to penetrate it. And the people that I do hear from, they're always telling me about their relatives, their kinsmen, how they rejected, leave the beast alone. That's what you do. Quit trying to tell them. But Yahushua sent out his shulishim. He said, you go to a house and they receive you, you leave my blessings. You bestow the riches of Yah in that house. You go to that house that rejected, he said, dust your feet off and let them go to hell. We're in this time, you cannot ponder. When you hear the Torah of Yah, you don't harden your heart. They harm their damn wicked hearts. Why? Because Yah has caused darkness to enter in. When they knew Yah, they would not honor him. Yisrael, Yah, you must honor Yah. Every time you have a chance to esteem and exalt him, you must do it. You must do it, Yisrael, Yah. When you open up this congregation for us to enter in, you must let him know. Mighty is your name. When my body don't feel well, get up. When you get up, you'll feel better. There's a song of my days, get up everybody, no more sleeping. How did that go? Who knows that? Get up everybody, no more sleeping, whatever it was. But yeah, I know what he said. And when they heard that, everybody got up. Hey, get up everybody, no more sleeping today. Come on. Talk to me, Yisrael. Yeah. The Steelers in their days, they would sing the song, we are family. Everybody get up. Papa, I don't give a damn if they were 9 or 99. They got up. We hear the voice of Yah, we get up. And exclaim the magnificent excellence of his power. Yisrael, Yah. They did not honor Yah, so he gave them up to a dark mind. And what is in darkness? You don't know what's there. And yet out of darkness, he brought light, didn't he? He began everything in the darkness. The enemy caused us to be fearful of darkness. That's all right. We're going into we're already in the eve of the dark day, all right? Don't be fearful of it, Yisrael. Keep our minds purged and cleansed from all filth. He said, professing, or they began to claim themselves to be so-called. They be professed. Isn't everyone professing themselves to be wise? Come on, Avata, you telling the young men, come on, Ema, you telling the young girls, you're speaking against their ways. What about your ways? Your ways must exemplify the constitution of your own heart. Yes. Claiming themselves to be wise, they became evil. They became evil. They became fools. They became fools. They claimed themselves to be wise. They became fools. And then this is the catalyst here. And they began to shina. They began to change, to alter, and they change the kabod of the incorruptible, the honorable things of Yah, into an image made like the corruptible man, to birds and four-footed beasts. You see that? And creeping things. That's what this, the senility of this mark of this beast. We began to be allured by the creature things, and we changed the beauty of Yah. We don't see the Yah's beauty in the creation. We see we see our own loss and our own imagination, our own desires. There are those that they will never have enough. I don't care what Yah grants unto them. I don't care how much breath he gives to them. They're never satisfied. I don't care how much money they have. They're never contented. I've read lately how some of these ball players, one by the name of Allison Iverson, over $300 million, he's broke. This man by the name of Terrell Owens played football. He made nearly $100 million, and he is broke, don't even have a damn nickel. One that boxed during his days with Sugar Ray Leonard, Thomas Hearn, he's a multimillionaire. Rolls Royces and finery of homes and wines. He had to auction off everything that he had. A man that made millions, what a million was a million, by the name of Joe Frazier. And he dies in a lonely gym above the rooftop there in Philly. Broke. So money doesn't satisfy the heart. It is the truth of Yah. That's the only thing that's going to satisfy us. Men are broke. Make millions of dollars. I said to Oxymory one day, I said, can you imagine what we can do with $1 million? My, 500,000. I said, we're going to the light of Yisrael with that kind of money. That's a fact. We're going. Yah's going to see that. There's two things that he's going to grant me before I die. And it's going to happen soon. And I'm going to begin to work on both of them because he's put it there. One thing is that I want to do a scripture. Those are the diasporas. There's no, I don't know of anyone that has done a scripture for the people. No one. I'm going to buy the equipment. Yah's going to grant it unto us. We are going to buy the equipment. And I'm going to take about a year just to labor in the book and to refine words in a way that will be easy for everyone to understand. And I'm going to print a little small, thin, ultra-thin scripture that we can send all over the world to the people. And we're not going to sell it, Yisrael. Oh, we're going to ask for an offering to defray the cost. That's my passion. That's my desire. And then to make a pilgrimage to the land whereby our Zira, our sea, the heritage of Yisrael is promised you. Those are two things that I'm going to see. And I will fight death until those two things are done. You understand? Hallelujah. He's going to grant the funds for me to do that. He's going to grant the funds for us to do that. We're going to do it collectively, Yisrael. Why? Because when I'm there in the book, I will need your hands to do this. And when I'm out there doing this, I will need time to do that. You understand? He's going to get it done. I'm going to see that through. And we're going to have a beautiful book. It's going to be called the Torah Truth Scripture. Chitvei. It's going to be done. No, this is no imagination of my heart. This is what he has put there. Hallelujah. I was talking to one of the Zakeins. He said, well, you know, Reach and Yah's time is good. I said, no, it's his time now. It's his pleasure for me to do that. It's right to do right. I don't have to get on my knees and pray about that matter. I don't have to seek Yah for some kind of epiphany or some kind of spiritual resolution. It's already there. When a man delights himself in Yah, he will give him the very desire. This has not come by my own proclivity, by my own desire. To be recognized. Damn me. I'm not worth a damn. He's the one that justifies us. Yeah. We knew Yah. We did not honor him. We were not told down. It opens up one of the most vilest of doors. And Yah says, when you change the truth of Yah, when you change his beauty into an image like a corruptible man. So that's what these liars have done in these whorehouses. Made Yah and relegated him to one as a man. That's why they tell everyone you are gods. And I will not fight against that. They are gods. Because Hashem said the day you defy the Most High, the way that Yah never called us that. He said the day you defy Yah, the day that you eat from this forbidden truth or this knowledge, he said you will become gods. You will become Elohim. You will become like him. Knowing the difference. Knowing the difference. Yah are the difference between truth or Tav and Ra. That's what he said. And so man today elect his own right way, doesn't he? That's what we do, what is right in our own sight. And mine, he is one. We are a people that do what is right in our own sight. And all the ways of a man, they're right in his own sight. And all of our ways, I don't care what it comes to. Yeah, everybody got a different opinion. Everyone got a different synopsis of Yah. Everyone got something that they know that Yah spoke to them. And they are damn liars. He is Ekat. There is only one truth. There is no diversity of Yah's truth, and they're nothing but pharisaic liars corrupting the truth. He deals with us as a people that have fallen. That's what the Torah is about, to restore people back unto him. And it reveals our wicked, corrupt ways that are vile, sadistic, and unclean. It shows us the very wicked one that pours in the filth in our minds. And how we as a people do not resist that, but we resist Yah. We must begin to impel the affections of our flesh and the lust of our flesh. We must destroy, we must impel, not crucify, but impel, kill it, destroy it. We must impel it. We must impel it. It must be destroyed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And because of this, it says this, wherefore, Yah also gave them up to uncleanness, to this vile sexual uncleanness of practice, to this ritual filth of their religious ways and their God ways. He gave them up to that which was tum'ah, through the lust of their own hearts, to the lust of their own levim. Through our own hearts, he's given us up to that lust because we will not honor him. When we knew him, we will not reverence him. He gave us up to drink of this wicked cup. I want you to hear this. So to dishonor their own bodies between themselves. What are you saying, Yah? He said, who change who hafach. They change Yisrael. They have overthrown. They have overrun the Torah of Yah. They have hafak, like a hawk. A hawk flies over the chickens or the birds of capture, doesn't it? They have hafak. They have overthrown. They have overcharged, overrun. Who changed the truth of Yah into a lie. They have changed the truth. They have changed the Torah to accommodate Christians and their damn Jesus and their damn lords and their Baal. They changed the Torah. They change the truth of Yah into a lie, and they worship and serve the creation, everything, the creature. They worship houses and cars and things and creature things. Got mine, you got to get yours. I went, got mine, you got to get yours. And they don't have a damn thing. They don't even have a grave to lay their bodies in, Yisrael. You don't own a damn thing in this earth. Don't pay the taxes, you're fired out. You got some pride in that, you're fool. Yah set up the system. You came into this earth with nothing and you're leaving with nothing. You're not going to hold the titles of nothing. I don't care if you got millions to pay for years. One day the millions run out. You're not going to defy that constitution. You brought nothing in. You're not taking nothing out of this world. And that's the fact, it all belongs to Yah, still belongs to him. Everything here and here is made from the ores of Yah. Yah has created the dust and the dirt and the trees and the seeds. Everything made from Yah. And you don't give him todah for that? Come on, Yisrael, Yah. They worship the creature more than the creator, who is blessed forevermore. So be it. Amen, amen. Let it be fulfilled, Yisrael, Yah. It says this now. It says, for this zuch, for this cause, for this reason, for this whereas, or because of, for this cause, Yah gave them over unto vile. He gave them over unto Nibala. Nibala. N-E-B-B-E-L-A-W. Nibala. It's a law that they have created from their own wicked mind. We have laws that even though we know we are unjust and we're doing injustice to our ach or our hope, we abide in those wicked laws. We continue to do what is right in our own eyes. So Yah gave them over unto a vile affection. Even the woman did change the natural sexual relationship use in that which is against nature. Did I not begin this teaching in the book of Dibarim, where Yah says that even the woman going or lying with womankind like mankind, is it not a pigul? Is that an abomination for a woman to lie with a woman? Is it an abomination for a man to lie with a man? It is an abomination for Eddie Long to go down there and rape these young boys as a pedophile. Is that an abomination? Is it not an abomination for these butch bulldaggers to embrace and to take advantage of young girls? Is that an abomination? Is it not vile for these faggot teachers and these teachers that teach your babies to rub on them in their pedophile manner? And we're so damn dumb and ignorant, we give them unto these unclean bastards out of hell to seduce and to take advantage of them. Is that an abomination? Is that an abomination for a man to sleep with a beast? Is that an abomination for a woman to sleep with a beast? Yes. All right then, we concur on that. I got something else to show you. You see, when one began to drink from this cup, when they do abominable things, they have no conscience of what they're doing that's abominable. And they don't understand the dredge of this cup and what is in this cup. Yah says, I gave them over. He changed their minds. He altered their minds. He gave them over. He says, for this cause, Yah gave them up. It's almost like your mama said, I throw my hands up. That's it. Yah, I'm not going to worry. That's get out of my house, boy. I've had it with you. I'm done. No more. In the days when the parent did that, they meant that. They was, what you say, my ark? Say it aloud again. That's right. They could see you downtown. They didn't speak. They walked. Daddy would turn his head. He's no son of mine. He didn't know ya. Mama could see that slutty heifer. She would not take a dime if she was broke. She would not take it. She would not take it. She would not take it. She would not. She would say, you ain't welcome in my house. And she would not let her come. She will not come that dressed like a floozy Jezebel. She will not let her come. She will not let her touch anything in the house with all the more long fingernails and painted. How do they even wipe their buttocks, as my Israel said one day? And getting all kind of filth on. Come on. How is it that a woman got a husband let some man play with the toes and paint? That's a stupid bimbo. That's a freak of a freak. I don't care what you say. You can defend it. I will not. Come on, you bathetids, Zion. You out there letting some man paint your toes or some freak of a woman. That women do that, that they're freaks. And you think you look nice with purple toenails and pink one and a green one. You look silly as hell. It's pagan. It's satanic. We're going to deal with that. I went back to the archives and I saw a message I began in 2009. I'm going to teach it here soon because of the question this ark asked me. All right. Moving quickly here. He gave them up to vile affection, and likewise, 127, the men also leaving the natural sexual relationship with the woman, burning in their own lust one toward another, men with men, committing wicked, shameful acts. That's a shameful act. It should not even be spoken of, and that I'm careful. I know our little ones. They don't understand the totalness or the totality of that, but it is so vile. It is so unclean. And they're promoting that on the television. They got these men that are pronounced faggot beasts out of hell, trying to talk like a woman, taking hormone shots to alleviate their bodies of hormones, to make their bodies soft. Y'all gave a man a hard body. I don't care how thick he gets, even on all that thickness, you can feel the hardness there. That's what he made man, to bend his back and to labor in the field. That's why he gave him a back like that. He didn't give a woman a back like that. He didn't give her the strength in her back. He gave her strength in her lower parts, in her hips to carry babies. He gave a man a back to bear the burden of the yoke, Israel. And yet they're taking this away, making them effeminate. Men dressing like women, women like men. It is vile. It is vile. For a woman to lie with another woman is an abomination, isn't it? For a man to lay with a man, is that an abomination, Yisra'iyah? Is that an abomination? For a man to lay with a beast, is it a pigul? It's a pigul. It is a shitkutz. It is vile. It is wicked. It is unclean. Isn't it so? For a man to take another man's wife and lay with her, isn't that an abomination? For a man to take a child and to lay with a child, is that an abomination? Has that changed? Has it changed from that day to that day? It is still the same. And so is this. I want you all to hear this. You, daughter, Tizayonda, just hold that and turn quickly to the book of Dibarim, Deuteronomy 22. I don't care if you don't like it. I want to read a couple things that I want to, I'm going to finish up back there in the book of Romaya. The book of Dibarim, chapter 22, verse 5. It says that a woman, she shall not hacha, she shall not wear, she shall not abide, she shall not wear that which pertain or cheli, which pertain to a valiant warrior or the garments of a man. Neither shall a valiant warrior put on a woman's simla, the wrap, the mantle, the proper garment for a woman. What would it look like if I got on a skirt here today? What would it look like if I got on a dress? Dibarim 22 verse 5. What would it look like if I walked in here with a dress on today? What would it look like if I came in here dressed like my Isha? It would be an abomination unto Yah. He does not intend for our babies, our daughters to wear the things, and they got diseases and all kind of things penetrating in their bodies, and you put them on them damn tight jeans. It's an abomination. There's a dress. Come here, wife. A woman should dress like this. I'm a man. You see, the garment is different. You all look in there. You see that? You can't get it all. But see, she dressed like a woman. She got on a dress. I got on what Daddy would say, breeches. He made breeches for a man. If a woman puts, if she wears what I got on, and I, what if we switch clothing? Would you listen to me? If we switch clothing right here, would you listen to me? If I came in here dressed like her, had some lip chap gloss on my lips, would you listen to me? No, you would not. You would think I'm a faggot. You would think I'm a dog. There's a proper simla for the woman. There's a proper simla for the woman. Her beauty is in her clothing. Her beauty is in her dress, Yisra'ya. And this wicked world has taught you to dress your daughters like whores, and you sell them out for a damn $2 cents. Because your mind is given over unto the abominable activities of darkness. You all raise your hands and you declare that it's wrong for any longer to sleep with the boys. Is it wrong? Is it wrong for me to sleep with the beast? Is it wrong for her to sleep with another woman? Is it wrong for me to sleep with a man? Are they abominations? Have they changed today? They have not changed, neither has that. It's an abomination. That's why you get off your lazy buttocks and learn how to sew and make your daughters. You can design clothes so beautiful that all the girls in school will know where you get that from. That is so beautiful. Hell, you're lazy as hell. You lay around, don't want to do a damn thing. That's the way you are. Come on, man. I don't give a damn how much money you make. Par your lifestyle down and let her stay home and take care of the children and love the babies. Struggle and go through it. You'll be all right. You're not going to lack anything, man. I read that again. I'm going to come. I want to show you how filthy this is now. He says, a woman, again, Deuteronomy 22, Father, woman shall not wear that which pertain to a man, neither shall the man wear that, put on a woman's garment. For all that do so are abomination to Yah, your Abba. Does it say that? For all that do so is an abomination to Yah, your Abba. Does it say that? For all that do so, when you sell, you offer your daughters over unto hell. You dress them in the way of a harlot, of a zana. You dress them that way to offer up accolades to the world. You dress them that way to give credence unto the powers of hell. That they're drinking out of the cup of darkness and hell. And you give them that way to offer them up in the valley of Hinnom. That they burn in their own lust. They got that mama dressed like a dirty slut. I'm going to say it, Israel. There's a time that we must turn around. We must shuv. We must make teshuvah. And you got pants so tight in your buttocks and your private part. You think you're holding something? You're holding nothing but a damn glob of fat under your gut and a stinking body part. It's wrong. It's not right. It's not right. It's wrong. You shouldn't wear that. I'll say it again. If a man sleep with a man, it's an abomination. Let me read this. All right, hold up. Turn quickly to Dibarim. This is the cup. I want to get back and finish, though. Here in the book of Dibarim. Hallelujah. I want to ask you, are these abominations? And Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse, let me read quickly, 9. Dibarim 18, verse 9. Yah says, when you come into the land which Yah your Abba give you, he said, you shall not learn to do after the abominations of the two Abba of the nations. Is that correction? Is that proper instructions? You'll have that Deuteronomy 18:9. He said, you don't learn to do the same wickedness of the nation. There shall not be found among you anyone that make his sons and daughter pass through the fire of divination of Keshem. Should you give your sons and daughters over to witchcraft, Harry Potter, and the delusion of their mind? Should you do that? Come on, Yisrael, y'all talk to me, people. You shouldn't do that, do you? Or a son or a daughter, you know, pass through the fire of divination, or an observer or an onan, you practice witchcraft or root doctor work. Should we practice witchcraft? Should we go to root doctors, Yisraya? Now, you that understand what I'm talking about, root doctors, should we go to palm readers and charmers? We shouldn't go to that, should we? Of time. Or enchanters or nahash, those that are observance of omens and signs. Should we go to them that they read the palm of your hand, that they read your irises? Should you go to people like that? Should we be reading the horoscopes and all that? No, we shouldn't. He said, or a witch then. Should we go to witches and sorcerers or witch doctors? He said, or charmers in verse 11, or consulters or sha'el, those that consult with familiar spirits or demons and ghosts, or wizards or yirani or ghosts or necromancer. He says this in verse 12. If we do any of that, is it right before Yah? It's not right, is it? He said, for all that do these are an abomination to Yah. So if I go to the root doctor, is that an abomination? Is my heart darkened? Have I been drinking from the cup of the wicked one? You can reject it all you want to, but it's still the truth. You can harden your heart against Yah and not begin to transform your actions and your ways. You're going to die in your damn wickedness, man. Woman, you're going to die in all your damn corruption. And your tight blue jeans are not going to save your ass from hell. What'd that do? Get off your lazy ass, woman, and learn how to sew. You can go to places and find dollar stuff, little old cheap stuff, and fix your daughters up in a way that even all the world will envy them. And that's a fact. You got this damn worldly mentality. You don't know how to do anything. You lay around on your ass and you don't want to learn how to do anything. It is right, my Emma. And the day a young gal know how to cook before she knew what cooking was. Could sew, could mend. Come on, Yisrael. Yeah. So of all these things, to go to enchanters and sorcerers, if all that's an abomination, to lay with a man, then where does that come from? It's not from the cup of Yah. It's from the cup of devious work, Yisrael. Yeah. And when your heart get real, when you harden your heart, you don't harden your heart in the day of provocation to provoke Yah. That he said, damn you, Jezebel. You harden and say, well, I just seek Yah. You don't seek a damn thing. He's telling us the truth. You do what he commands you. You can try to read it in anything you want to. You can try to read it all you want to. It's self-explanatory. Hallelujah. Doesn't the stop sign say stop out there? You can tell the low man what I thought. No, it says stop. You got to know that before you can pass the test to get your driver's license. Well, how fast were you doing? I was doing 55. What does it say? 35. Well, that's the speed. Well, I thought, no, sir. It is 35 unless otherwise posted. You know that. So unless Yah says something else, then you know what it is. That's all right. You're not going to get by. I got you. Hallelujah. The word got you. He said, for all that do these things are an abomination to Yah. And because of these abominations, Yah does drive them out from before you. He said, the reason Yah drive them out, that you don't learn these abominations. We got to drive out the spirit of this harlotry of our mind, this mark of this unclean thing. We got to drive it out. We cannot continue to walk in that, Yisrael. You don't sell mothers, your babies, to the valley of Hinnom. You don't dress them like they get old enough, they want to buy their own, they're out of your house. Let them dress any way they want to. But you don't dress them like that. You don't dress them like that. You dress them in garments that are, you dress them in simla. Man, you don't dress. I said again, you all that's listening, looking, you that are here in this small gathering, if I came in here with the dress on, what would you think? Be honest. Come on, someone tell me. Would I look crazy to you? Yeah. I will look like a damn freak. You know I would. What makes you think that you don't look like a freak woman in pants? With these are women pants. There's no such thing as a women pant. It's almost a stupidity that a woman comes out in what she call a bikini, a pair of drawers and a bra, and yet she say, no, this is a bikini. No, Hef, it's a pair of drawers and a bra. If I came in with a bra on in here, my belly out this gut of mine, and a flowing skirt that's cut down low, come on, cut down to here, what would you think? Talk to me, Yisrael. I know what you would say. You would watch just for the freak show. That's what most folks would do. They love freaky mess like that. They'll turn that on. Look at that sissy. Man, ain't nobody right. So give them justification. It's an abomination. And out of a cup, if you're drinking from that cup, you will practice these abominable things. You will practice necromancing, no different than you dressing like a man, woman. You will practice charming and soothsaying, no different man than you dressing like a woman. Painting your lips, trying to do your hair like a woman, no different than that. It's no different at all. You know, it's amazing that it's difficult for us to obey Yah and to hear what he's saying. We trouble. We just, only thing we say is, Yah, help me. I don't care what your trouble, just say, Yah, help me. Help me, Yah, to bring that resolution. Help me, Yah. I don't give a damn what daughters, I don't give a damn what they say. You dress them under your roof the way Yah commands you. That's how you do it. You don't dress them in little hot pants and little shorts and short off their buttocks, making them whores. Come on, you know when you dress like that, what came of you? Why would you dress them like that? You know what things we have done because we've dressed like that. Y'all said, drive them out because I don't want your minds to be infested with these vile, abominable things. He said, the garments they wear, they're unclean. I don't want you women dressing like that. And they're putting all these dyes and chemicals in these pants. And the women wearing these blue jeans so damn tight is insane. You wonder why the men don't respect them. You wonder why they're laying with them like damn dogs, like a beast. That doesn't attract a man. Their buttocks dirty, those jeans dirty, stinking. Where they become inborn type bacteria in there, that's the truth. Where they wash, they don't get them out. The bacteria become immune to the killing bleaches and stuff like that. And they wonder why they're having problems. The enemy used that to destroy the woman, the ability to birth. Ability for a woman like this to never have child, or maybe even me. And drawers are so tight that's pressing one's testicles against one's body that it destroys the very essence of that. That's why Yah drove them out, Yisrael. The woman don't dress like a man. She doesn't dress like a man. We have a message on the abomination that make it desolate. Play that after this message today, my akh. All right? Hallelujah. It's broken down even greater. One more thing here. He says, for these things, in verse 4, things, for these things which you shall possess, listen to observe of time and diviners or kossam. But as for you, Yah, your Abba has not suffered you to do so. Yah, your Abba will raise up you in a Navi from the midst of your brothers like me. Him shall you hear. We can't dress like that, Yisrael. You women, it is an abomination for man to lie with mankind like woman can. And the only reason you're dressed that way because Yah has given you up to do all that which is unclean. You can shout all the hell you want to. You don't harden your ruach when you know what is right to do. When one knows what is tough to do and do it not or does it not, it is a sin. And it begins with you, mama. It begins with daddy. Daddy may not know Yah, but it begins with you, mama. You don't have to fight. You don't have to resist daddy. You do what's right. And you walk in what's right. And you will begin to see the change in daddy. A man that doesn't even know Yah, doesn't even care for Yah, you will begin to see that in him. It's an abomination. And that which is an abomination, it is an unclean thing from a mind that is depraved, it is filthy, it is corrupt, that offer up unto the powers of hell. You don't present your daughters, you don't make them prostitutes, that you bring whoredom in the land. You don't make them sell their bodies for what? For these filthy boys to look at them? Come on, they look in between their crouch. You know they are, mama. That's why you wear them like that, because you want men to look at you. Hell, I don't need women to look at me. Hallelujah. You wear them like that because you want them to admire you and look at you. You can get hard around your head all you want to. It makes no difference. You know that Yah's dealing with you. You go to either, if you say you love Yah and keep not his commandment, was that a commandment? Was that a statute? Sure it is. You can say what you want to. Is this not our, one of the first five books of the book? It is the Torah then, isn't it? He says that the woman shall not wear that. She should not wear that which pertains to a man. Neither shall a man put on a woman's garment. Is that simple to understand? Yes. Is that simple? Yeah. Someone email me and tell me, is that simple to understand? He said, he shall not put on a woman's garment. Yeah. So they're trying to blur the gender now, are they not? Yeah. Unisexual. I don't want nothing unisexual. Yeah. I wouldn't even buy a damn watch. It was $10,000. I'd get it for $5 if it's unisexual. I don't want nothing that's unisexual. For a man or a woman, that's not so. Yah made a woman, he clothed her with titties and buttocks to have babies. A buttock is, in many cases, bigger than a man. He clothed her different. He clothed a man different. And if he clothed us different in our flesh, he clothed us different with our garments. Women did not start wearing these garments until after really World War II. When they needed women to work, go in the factories, they started smoking, they started dressing like men. And that's when the woman libs came out. And that's a fact. They wore dresses. I've never seen my grandmother with a pair of pants on. Never. Even my mother, before she died, I watched this woman. I said, you can't wear them. You know that's wrong. In all my ignorance. I saw that woman come out of pants and never wore another one. Oh, baby, I don't wear that no more. All right. It's beautiful. You look much better that way, mama. You shouldn't wear that. Well, I got to work in the field. Hell, I can take you and show you pictures where they chop cotton all day long. I can see my grandmother with that big frock on, that apron on, coming to the cotton field, chopping cotton with us and picking cotton. That's what chopping is, picking cotton. I can see that. I remember that. In cotton fields, everyone had some oak trees out of that big old trees. So you can go in there and get a little shade out of the heat of the day. That's what they were for. Sit there a while. I enjoyed that as a kid. I was just ignorant. It was fun to me. It was fun picking cotton. A few pennies to add, we could have something to eat. I never saw my grandmother with a pair of pants on. She wore dresses. And she was a vile woman, a nasty mouth woman she was. She was very filthy mouth, but she wore pants. She wore dresses. And so the enemy is taking away the natural use of the woman to corrupt her parts, to corrupt them. How? To try to kill the seed, her ability to reproduce. Her menstrual cycle is so vicious and cramped and so hard on her. With all these dyes penetrating one of the most sensitive places on her body, that's not of Yah Yisrael. And they're wearing them so tight now, I don't even see how they sit in there. Their bellies roll over like a rolling water. Well, I wouldn't do that if I was that you would wear that. I see them 300 pounds with those stretch. I say, don't look at me, you nasty thing. I don't even look at people like that. I see that, I turn my head. Don't look at me. I don't even speak to people like that. You better know I'm not going to even entertain that filthy spirit. You shouldn't even put that in your daughters, mothers. You wonder why they're dishonoring their bodies. You got more little young girls in school that are lesbians and more little faggot boys in school. In my days, the boy danced with the girl, and these days they don't dance like that. The boys get up together and they dance. And then the girls get up together and they dance. So they look at the girls dance and say, I like her. If you get up on the dance floor, in my days, you had to have a woman to dance with. You dance with the boy, you were a sissy. That's how they do it today. I know what I'm saying. That's how they do it. That's how they do it. Boys dance with boys. So they get up on the floor and they show off the thing and the girl. That's how they do it. And they do things erotic and filthy and vile. Mama, you're going to pay a price. I'm telling you that. You're going to pay a price, mothers. I'm telling you. Hallelujah. 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 Turning back to Romea. Chapter 1, verse 27. I want to close here with a few verses. I got one more teaching on this, and we're going to move on. I must move on. Romans chapter 1, verse 27. He said, and likewise, the men also leaving the natural use, relationship of the woman, burning in their lust one toward another, men with men, committing wicked and shameful acts, and receive back in themselves the recompense of the error which was meet. So we have AIDS running rampantly. You go to a city like Atlanta, these what they call bisexual. Y'all made nothing bisexual. Men with men and they're with women. And among those other diasporas, you have more women today with AIDS in a city like that. Young, attractive women don't even know they have AIDS. And they're nothing but death time bombs. The cauldron of wickedness because they will not honor Yah. When you honor Yah, Ma'ima, when he speaks to you, you obey it. I don't care what your children say. They've lost any kind of strength of understanding. You become creative and beautiful in their dress and nice little vests, long skirts and nice little, they will enjoy that. And you lay on your buttocks and you don't do a damn thing. Watch television. You play on the computer all damn day in chat rooms, but you don't have time for that. You want to learn how to sew, you can sew if you want to. It's not difficult to do that. Buy a little jean material, make them dresses. The girls, girl, where you? Oh, I like that girl. Boy, that's so cool. Sure, they would tell them that. You want them to be distinct and distinguished. They look different. You go to school, the girls will know they look different. And you, I guarantee you will find many of the young girls trying to dress like them. I've watched that. I have seen that. You will find the women dressing like the ones that are appropriate. When a woman gets dressed up, what she put on? Hillary Clinton is the only woman that wears pants all the time because of her old horse, cow, pig legs. I said again, Hillary Clinton is the only woman that wears pants all the time in pantsuits because she got pig-looking legs. They look like pig meat. That's what her old Velcro vein legs look like. So huge and so big. Calf's bigger than an arm. A woman's calf shouldn't be bigger than an arm. Man's calf, he got calves that big and his arms that big. It shouldn't be that way. That's not a symmetry of a man. That's a fact. And she got these big cow legs, these pig legs. Every time you see it, very seldom you see Hillary Clinton in a dress. But when a woman get dressed up on the red carpet, what they call the Oscars and all that, what do the women wear? Talk to me again. They wear dresses. They wear gowns. They wear the flowing, expensive gowns, do they not? They wear $50,000, those dresses, $50,000, $60,000, $70,000, $100,000. That's what they wear. And they borrow it, they rent it. They're just simply using them for advertisement. The rich, wealthy women buy those dresses. You don't see, come on. The mess on the runway in Paris, that's just a prototype of what's coming. And all the ones you see with pants on because their old legs are broken up, the hideous. But them young girls, they ain't wearing nothing that doesn't show off their figurine. Even the old ones, they get the liposuction. They suck the fat out. They get that body toned down. They live for just that one day. And then they may pig out after, but they live for that day. And they ain't wearing no pants. They're wearing dresses. Come on, Beth. What are they wearing? When a woman wants to look professional, she dresses up in a dress, doesn't she? Or a suit. When I worked at IBM, it was no written code that a woman wear pants in management. But you didn't see them wearing pants. You saw them wearing dresses and suits, skirts. You didn't see them. They may come in there on the weekend with pants on, but during the week, I never saw Savannah Clay in a pair of pants. Never! And she was not going to Dollar Mart or Walmart. She didn't shop there. I talked to her husband, so I know how she shopped. When she went places, she would go spend $6,000-$7,000 in clothing, outfits. About 12, 13 outfits, and that's what she spent in shoes. That's how she dressed. She dressed like that every day. I talked to her husband. Her husband knew me. He honored me. He respected me. The first man that promoted me, he did that. That's the way she dressed. Never in pants. Never. Yah says it's an abomination, whether you buy it or not. It's filthy for you bath to dress in pants. It's filthy for a man to dress in a dress. I was in the prison house. I said, if I came in here with a dress on, what would you think? I said, I think you're a faggot, man. Come on. Come on. Can you imagine with a man with a dress on in that federal prison we were going to down there in Bennettville? They would rape him. They would rape him. If I walked in there with a dress, first of all, they would not even let me in. If I went to the prison house with a dress on, they would not even let me in. If I had gone there with a dress on, they would not even let me in. They were not even permitting me to go behind the walls. They were not. And when I would walk back there, some of them cats been in there 20 in life for 15 years. I remember one day I walked in there, and this cat, he was about 6'5". And so when I walked into the prison house, I don't back down. How did you walk? I stepped in there with the shooters. I knew who I was. I knew what I came to do. I was bold. Not arrogant, but I was bold. So when I walked in, he looked at me. He started looking like this. He's looking at me just like that. I saw him looking at me. And of course, I'm walking. I'm taking my strides, and I'm bold too. You know, I'm not afraid. I'm walking in that prison house with boldness. He's captivated now. And then when I get near him, I said, how you doing, man? Everything's all right. That's exactly how it is. I say, how you doing? How you doing? Everything's all right, man? How you feeling today? You all right? He didn't even respond to that. That's the truth. And so when they would see me coming, and those that call themselves the authorities in religious activities, they would see me, they wouldn't even, I'm telling you, they wouldn't even speak to me. The one that was all loud that in Islam and all that, he knew what I was talking about because I would talk loud enough for everybody to hear me. He wouldn't even speak to me. He'd look at everyone else, talk to everyone. But when I would come, they would not even let me behind the walls if I had on a dress. They were not. I had to be dressed in a garment of a man. So there's a distinct garment of a man and a woman. It is. Yeah. Women on bras, they have what they call dots, don't they? Where the breasts, so they can, on blouses. In the days I hear the women talking about, well, you know the dot, you know. Come on, talk to me. Yes. I know in the 60s I would hear them say that, the dot. That means that there was a line from there to there, so when the breasts, you know, it would give room for the breasts, dots. Was that what they call them? Okay, what is that? Dart, okay, what? Okay, that's it, dart. I was there though, dart. That's what they would call them, you know. So if I walked in the prison house with a dart, or, come on, Yisrael. It's an abomination whether you buy it or not. Y'all said they commit such shameful acts. And look at this now, Romans 1:28. And even as they did not like to retain Yah. See, when Yah speaks to us, we must retain what he says. We must hear it. When they did not like to retain Yah in the deum, in their knowledge, in their wisdom, understanding. When you don't retain Yah, listen, Yisrael. When you don't want to, by inspiration of his truth to you, when you don't allow that to reside in your heart, when you don't love Yah, when you reject that, it's a Yah gave them over unto Ma'as, unto a reprobate mind. Does it say a reprobate mind? And a Ma'as or reprobate mind is a mind. Ma'as is to reject, to defy. To have objection that you defied blatantly. So he gave them up to a mind that rejects him, rejects Torah, And he gives us the ingredients or the composition of that mind. He said, I gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not proper to do. It's not proper for a woman to dress like a man. It's not proper for a man to dress like a woman. It's not proper for us to be charmers. It's not proper for us to go to the root doctor. It's not proper for us to go to the palm reader. It's not proper, Yisrael. So he gave them over unto those things that are not proper or convenient to do. And he said, these are the manifestation of the spirits of those that will operate in that. Now, look what he says in verse 29. Hear this. He says, being filled. The word filled. Did I not use that word today? It says here in the book of Revelation, having a cup in her hand, male full. Was the cup full in her hand? Was the cup full in her hand? Was the cup male full in her hand? He says here, and being filled, her cup in her hand was filled with what? Abomination, fornications, nidah, and all filthiness. Was it not? It's a filthy thing for a woman to dress in a way that is not representative of her stature, her body, and what Yah commands. Remember one tabernacle, it was one here 2 years ago. That this arrogant little person, he doesn't have much to do with me now. I won't even mention his name. Because I would talk about this women dressing like that, he would talk about women dressing modestly. There are women that got on a bikini think they're modest. And it's not modest. There are women that walk around their little sons with nothing but a bra on and panties on. That's wicked. It's not modest. It's not right for your son to see you that way. It's not right for a son to see his mother that way. It's wrong. He knows what he sees in school or in his environment, what girls, why they wear that. It's wrong. That we said, when I was a child, I behaved and acted like a child. Now I'm a man, I put away that immature, those immature things. It is something about a woman, when she becomes a woman, she becomes bona fide. Her beauty is much more of essence. It's very beautiful. It is a creative sense of understanding in her own mind. It's not what she, it's not some $500 coat, $1,000 watch. It's not that. It's just when she put it on, boy, it's, the clothes doesn't make her. She makes what she puts on because of her beauty. And sometimes I will ask my wife, how does this look? I don't like it. She said, honey, don't worry about that. You all right. It's you. All right, girl, I like that then. Don't have to say nothing as I wear it, even though I don't want to wear it, but I'll wear it because what you say now. All right. Hallelujah. And being full, male, being full, in her hand, a cup full of abomination. Now, this is what they're filled with now. He says, being full with all evil. He said, they're full of zana, they're full of spiritual fornication and idolatry. They give their sons and daughters over unto every unclean thing. They're full of zima, full of evil plan. They plan evil. This is in the cup. This is what the poverty. Did I not define that by the main trim of definitions? Full of zima. Not only that, they're full of betsa, full of covetousness. They're greedy and they do anything to gain by their own violence. They will violate the Torah of Yah to gain attention, to gain perception, to gain those who look upon them as though they're beautiful. You silly woman. When a woman has the beauty, the essence of beauty, no one has to tell her she's beautiful. You don't have to. I wouldn't want a filthy old man telling me, girl, you're holding something. Come on, you daughters. I wouldn't want a wicked old woman telling me you're a fine thing. Well, I wouldn't even speak to nobody like that. I don't even respond to people like that. I don't even smile. I give them no reason to say that to me. You understand? Full of betsa, he says, not only that, but malicious. They're full of hamas. They will do violence against Yah. They're cruel. And they will do actions and deeds that are wrong against the Torah. When you become so cruel against Yah, you don't give a damn what he says. Well, I know what it says, but you're wrong. You're wrong. He says, full of chena, full of this vile disposition. We're jealous with envy. That's what's in this cup. It's full of this, Yisrael. This is what Yah give them over to, that they are filled with this. That it is a mark that is not of Yah, Yisrael. Not only are they full of chena, but they are full of rosach. They are full of murdering. They assassinate. They hate their brother and sister without a cause. They are full of reeb. They love to strive and debate the word. Well, I know what it says. But you can't wear that. No, she can't wear it. How many of you mothers will put your boys on a pair of hard pants? In my days, they call them hard pants. I mean, the boys wear that today, though. But how many of you fathers will put your boys on that? How many of you fathers will put your boys on a bra? Talk to me. How many of you will put your sons with a bra on? But you put your daughters in pants. You put your daughters in these little stretch things that even the print of their natural thing that should be covered, that honor, and you let these freaks, man, you go to die in your damn wickedness. You are a coward. Your damn daughters walk around you naked like a whore. That should not be. They should cover themselves. It's an abomination to young. He said, they are full of mirimah, they're full of deceit, they're full of treachery. They have the mind and the subtlety and the subtlety of Hashatan. And not only that, full of malignant, they're full of malice, they're evil thinkers, Yisrael. Did I not read in the beginning when I read the word, depraved definition? Did I not read malignity, malice? Was that not the first constitution of that word? They will speak against the messenger. Well, it's nothing wrong with that. You don't have to worry about that. You're a wicked man to tell your daughter, your son that. Your son dressed like a little faggot and acting like one that is effeminate. It's wrong for you to tell him that. Your daughter's dressing like a boy. It's wrong for you to dress her like that, mama. I don't give a damn what the world says. I don't care how uneducated, how ignorant you are. That means nothing to you. He said they're full of mirimah, full of deceit, and full of malignity. And they are lochash. They are whispers. Don't you know when we say things on our brother against Yisrael, it is to cast a curse or a spell upon them. That's why when someone comes in, you that's wicked. And you corrupt the mind of the one that listened to you. That's why we should speak the truth one unto another, every man to his neighbor. You should always speak truth. You should not whisper and lies, Yisrael. You conjure some of the most abominable, vile, evil things. This is what you'll feel with when there is a spirit of Tu'eba. When you are drinking from the cup, you will manifest in these ways. He shows us. He said, they are backbiters. We have never operated in that spirit, huh? He said, they're backbiters, those that bite, they're evil, they speak evil against one. And they saw they're the haters of Yah. They are booze, they are despiteful. There's a well or a spring of evil. That's what booze. There's a spring of evil that comes from them. They're despiteful. They do despite to each other. As my grandmother would say, you can be so despiteful. Don't do spite unto each other. He said, and not only that, but they are prideful. They don't see their pride, and they're full of rahab. They're boastful. They're driven with their arrogance and their wickedness. And not only that, they're inventors of evil things. They invent evil in their mind, in their imagination. That's what comes from this cup. An imagination against Yah. We invent evil things against Yah. And then we're disobedient to our parents. We're disobedient unto those that have a lawful place to instruct us in the things of Yah. Children are disobedient unto their parents, and they lie on them. They will go to school and lie on daddy. They go to school and lie on mama. They will go to school and lie. They will go to school and cheat. They will go to school and steal. They will go to school and change clothes. They will do all of that. Because mama doesn't work with them in a way that is proper, that is right. And there is no law of the Avat, there is no counsel of the father to lay down a strong, beautiful Torah in their homes. That's why they do it. When there's a Torah laid down in their home, they will do right. They don't go to school and see what they can get by from behind their parents' back. Why are we that way? Because we're without understanding. We don't have the binah of Yah. We have no power to discern. Without understanding, we are brit breakers. We break the covenant of Yah. We don't keep covenant. And then he says this, without natural, without lib, without a mind or a conscience that have been trained by Yahweh. We have drank from this cup full of all of these abominations. We are living, our mind has no understanding. We have no natural affection, no true love. When a woman loves her children, when she loves her sons and her daughter, she's not going to dress her son like a faggot. She's not going to dress her daughter like a butch bulldagger. I don't care how poor they were, the girls wore dresses in the days. I don't care what, I've looked at pictures of some of the ancient. I was looking the other day on the Huffing Report. I was reading the news whereby the slave wrote his master a letter. It was just discovered. And he told the master, he said, how are you doing? How is Mr. So-and-so, how is that? He said, master, you know you owe me money. He said, consider the days that I worked for you and all I've done for you, my wife and my children. You owe us around $14,000. He said, over all those years, he said, and consider you sent me to the doctor 4 times, taking that out, taking the food, although we grow our food, and although we did that, he said, you still owe me that. He said, now, if you want me to consider coming back and working for you, he said, I'm doing well now. I make $25 a month. He said, you pay me my money, and then I will consider your heart what kind of man you are. He said, you have been an evil man. You did me wrong, and you were not kind to me. You did not care for me at all. You did my children, my wife. You abuse us. Now, if you get any kind of, you got any kind of heart, any kind of sense of humanity, send me my money first. And you can send my money here. I got, you can put it in this trust. We're slaves to a system that corrupts us. Hallelujah. Without natural affection, he said, we are implacable. Now, I want you to hear this. You know what's implacable? It is the same word almost as zah, as a prince. A zah. It is Zah, but it is a stubborn, hard-headed, divisive mind against Yah. It is stubborn. You hear it and you still are not going to do it. You're resentful that he told you that, and you're rebellious. It is a mind that is unmerciful. It is a mind that understands not the hasid of Yah. I want to close with one verse here. Shirak speaks about the seed of those that are unmerciful. Hear this in Shirak. It says in Shirak 35:18, he says, and Yah will not delay, neither will he be patient with the Rasha, the wicked. Why? Until he crush the loins of the unmerciful. He's going to kill the unmerciful. And out of this cup, it is no mercy in it. It is the mark of the beast and man. That Billy was not merciful with that goat yesterday. Yah's going to crush the loins of the unmerciful and repay vengeance on the heathens till he take away the multitude of the insolent and break the scepter of their wickedness. The last verse in the book of Romans, Yah, you know these things, you've heard them today, right? He says, who knowing the judgment of Yah, that they which commit such things are worthy of death. You continue in these things, you're worthy of death. Not only do the same, not only do we do that, but we take pleasure in others who do that. Girl, you look fine in that. Turn around, let me see you. But we take pleasure in those that practice these things. Oh, mama, you look so nice. She doesn't look nice. She looks like a dirty Jezebel. She looks like a overweight, dirty, filthy thing. That's what she looks like. She doesn't look nice. She looks unclean. It's an abomination. And that is what the cup, the Malaya, the Menachith, this cup of sacrifice, it sacrifices you. It takes your mind because the mind must be prepared to offer up on the Hashatan. So when Yahshua comes, the kingdom of Yah comes, we will resist it and fight against it. That's what we fight against this. And the truth of Yah. May the riches of Yah rest upon Kol Yisrael. Yah may strengthen you all. Because your bosom to delight in all Torah. We appreciate you that have joined us on this Shabbat. And you that have joined us on Shabbat evening in Shemach Yisrael. The audience is growing beautifully. I appreciate you that joined us. You that have joined us today. We're trying to do all we can. But it takes your assistance. It takes your help. The money is in the PayPal account. We watch it as those collectors, they don't regard Shabbat. They take it out electronically. I looked this morning and they're taking it. because of the things we must pay for to keep the live stream. Send a gift to help. Send your tithes and offering here. These men are liars that say tithes are over with. They are damn liars. If that's the case, why do they have jugs and trays to take up gifts and all that? Send your gifts and offerings here. Bring your tithes. Send them here. I will utilize them properly. So help us, Yisrael. This word is a blessing to you. It bless your home. Send a gift. I greet you all again in Yeshua's name. May he barak you all. I'm tired and lazy now. Let us stand to our feet. I pray that Yah enrich you all. Message did go a little awkward today, but that's all right. I don't take nothing back. I want us to acknowledge him in all things. Hallelujah. In all things, acknowledge Yah, right? And what shall he do? He shall direct our paths, will he not? So let us in all things acknowledge him and let him direct our paths. In all things, Abban, Yeshua's name, we barak you this Shabbat for all things. We total you for your healing, those that need healing, that have joined us in this broadcast. Heal, I pray, in Yeshua's name, those here, those that are abroad in every place. Strengthen, heal, touch the hearts of those that they may help and assist in this labor. In Yeshua's mighty name, prepare our hearts for the coming of our King, Yeshua HaMashiach, as we wait for your fullness, your name to be honored and magnified among your people, among the heathens as well. We told you this day for all things, for the bread of life, Yeshua, above all things, and help us to love to Achav Yisrael, our brothers, our sisters, our neighbors, our friends. We have a great love for them in Yeshua's name. We ask these simple blessings, Yah, and guide us and go with us and keep us in the direct the way of Torah. We ask all this in Yeshua's name. With the volume of our loins, we cry, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Amen. Yabarak Yisrael.